Joining me now is Professor Swaran Singh from the Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Professor Singh, welcome to World Today. Now, before we come to the optics and outcomes from the Xi-Biden summit, I want to ask you straight up, what were Biden and Xi hoping to achieve with these talks?
I think very clearly, Ramesh, it has a direct message to their domestic audience, mm-hmm. as also their respective friends and allies, in particular U.S. friends and allies. Mm-hmm. And the meeting was on request of President Joe Biden. And as we know, President Joe Biden has been having difficulties at home with rising inflation, with the pandemic raging, and of course, this recent, this sudden precipitous withdrawal from Afghanistan. So numbers have been really plummeting in this case. To some extent, that could also be true of President Xi Jinping. You have been looking at reports of energy shortages, property crisis, and of course, his very critical time of seeking his third term as Secretary General, General Secretary of CPC, and then, of course, President. So I think it was primarily driven by their domestic, and to some extent, a message to their friends and allies. So fundamentally, what has come out is that they have kind of paid lip service to usual things, to just put them on the table without actually meaning much about them. Mm-hmm. But fundamentally, a sense that this mutually hurting stalemate of last almost 5 years now of technology, trade wars, and all kind of other tensions, which recently saw President Xi Jinping not appearing either in Rome's G20 meeting or in climate change meeting, which would have given some chance to President Joe Biden to have some kind of either body language, if not a direct conversation. Mm-hmm. And therefore, this meeting became suddenly so much more important to make sure that they are seen talking together. The only message that comes out very clearly is that both have kind of indicated that they don't want to see their competition veering into some kind of conflict. That, I think, is a concrete message that they have tried to give out. Otherwise, I think it was just a setting of stage, I will say, from where maybe they have had two phone conversations before.
That's right.
But this kind of a 3.5 hours, as Ramesh, you just mentioned, meeting is more or less, I think, kind of gauging each other and setting the stage, in which case, I think, President Xi Jinping has come out with a stronger light if you look at the domestic constituencies being what they are addressing. But it's a good opening for President Joe Biden also.
Sure. Professor Singh, you've covered a lot of ground in your opening intervention there, but I want to focus a bit more on the optics and outcomes, if any, from the summit. Now, in your estimation, does the summit bode well for the world, or do you think the US-China tensions will persist for the immediate future?
I think it's definitely a step forward, but it's not a kind of a game-changing meeting, because it fundamentally takes forward what President Joe Biden stands for, which is fundamentally to continue with the policies of President Donald Trump, which means the competition between the United States and China is not disappearing, but it's going to be handled a little more in a subtle fashion, in a more finesse in terms of interacting with each other. And that is a continuation of Joe Biden repeatedly saying America is back, and therefore giving certain reassurance to its allies and friends that that kind of continuous sort of trade and technology war between the United States is not going to be really hurting much of the global geopolitics. And therefore, they have started some conversation. But as I say, this is kind of primarily addressing their domestic constituencies, their own personality projections as being in responsible state of mind and willing to engage each other to some extent. Nothing more than that. I think it's kind of a first step, as I would say.
Sure.
But definitely, it does carry a symbolism in that sense that both have begun to realize that it makes sense to begin to talk to each other, even if they have enormous number of tensions, differences. If you heard the President Joe Biden's speech at climate change summit also, in that case, President Joe Biden has been fairly, firm and strong in terms of criticizing China on various occasions, on various issues. Mm-hmm. But when they met, you saw the unusual effort to show that bonhomie between two of them. And therefore, I think basically setting the stage effort on both sides, but much more on the side of President Joe Biden to set the stage as if we are sort of beginning to talk to each other and things might move in a direction where the tension would not be hurting either the bilateral relationship and the fact that they are the largest and second largest economy. As we begin to talk of post-pandemic resilience of global economy, they're talking to each other, possibly sends a good signal to markets, to politicians in other countries that there is going to be perhaps hope of economic resurgence, resilience, where these two economies are not constantly undercutting each other. So many issues. For example, Chinese had made promise of buying $200 billion of goods to bring little more balance in US-China trade. That hasn't happened so far. Even when Chinese claim that they have had a positive growth, I mean, they have hit their economy as they claim 100 trillion yuan, which is about $16 trillion. But you know, they could have done that in purchasing more products from America to give them reassurance. And Joe Biden repeatedly underlines how industries and workforce is under sort of danger because of Chinese trade becoming one-sided increasingly, and has taken measures on that issue also. So I think it's basically confidence building kind of an exercise, a good beginning, I would say.
Professor Singh, you spoke about messaging or signaling to other countries, and that gives me a perfect segue to my next question to you. What's in it for India? How should India read the just concluded Xi Biden summit?
That's an excellent question, Ramesh. I think that is something that all of us should be carefully sort of analyzing. Because the fact that the United States so suddenly left Afghanistan, and that had sent some kind of sort of question marks as to whether India should depend on the United States and how much India should depend on the United States. And now this opening of dialogue with the Chinese president, you can recall that way back when India had conducted the nuclear tests in 1998, President Bill Clinton had come to Beijing and signed a joint statement that how China and the United States will manage South Asian security together, and that had upset so many people in India. So this kind of warming up with China does have some implications for India-United States relations, because after all, every country, you know, is driven primarily by their own national interests. So in that sense, the fact that during President Donald Trump's time, there was enormous tension between China and United States, that had definitely contributed to how United States felt increasingly inclined to cultivate and engage India at a very rapid pace. So it could be that if United States, China begin to sort of hold hands and work together, this could have then therefore some implications for India-United States relationship. But you know, that is not to say that India-United States relationship is entirely dependent on how US treats China. To some extent, that has some influence, but you know, there's also enormous amount of autonomy that India-United States relationship has had. There's a bipartisan support, there are foundational agreements, whole lot of things that India and United States have gone together, largest trading partner. In that sense, there is a lot of autonomy in that relationship, but one cannot overlook the fact that there could be an influence if United States starts coming sort of closer and building partnerships with the Chinese. It could have something to India to reckon with, to be noticing those things in terms of how they will then take forward India-United States relationship.
Professor Singh, I'll come to the three T's, as some people call it, Taiwan, trade and technology, momentarily. But on a related issue, in terms of security in the wider Indo-Pacific region where India is invested heavily, how do you look at the so-called new arms race? We've seen China conduct a number of tests, including a hypersonic missile test. There's an arms race shaping in the Indo-Pacific region. You know, their nuclear technology as well. So how should India, should India be actually be worried about the Chinese, the trajectory on those, on these issues?
China definitely has put enormous focus on their indigenous military modernization, whether it is electromagnetic spectrum, or it is AI, or it is, let's say, several other equipment like stealth aircraft. You mentioned of hypersonic missiles. There was a whole lot of reports from the United States of China actually expanding silos and then stockpiles of its ballistic missiles. Actually, ICBMs were suspected. So yes, China has focused enormously on modernizing of its armed forces.
Right.
They have clearly put a date on 2035 when they want to make a People's Liberation Army a world-class force which should not only fight but win wars. They are already constructing the fourth aircraft carrier, no doubt on that. But I must also underline their competition primarily is with United States. And mm-hmm. United States has really pivoted towards Asia-Pacific region, as you just mentioned, Ramesh. And the gap between United States and China is really enormous. And when you put United States along with its friends and allies, then the gap really increases far too much. So I don't see China beginning to threaten United States and friends and allies right. in the Pacific region. But yes, the modernization does have certain impact on how equations are handled at the local level.
Professor Singh, one last question, very quickly if you don't mind. I want you to take a step back and look at these two personalities, Xi Jinping and Joe Biden. Now, Biden came into this summit riding on the back of a $1.2 trillion infrastructure bill, which was passed by both houses, both parties in the legislature. On the other hand, Xi Jinping has just been, the Communist Party just passed a resolution in his name, only the third time in Chinese history. How do you look at these two personalities? Can they do business together? Can they work together going forward?
Ramesh, I think they don't have much option about it because definitely Joe Biden is elected for 4 years. He's going to be in office for 4 years. President Xi Jinping, as you just mentioned, is kind of all set to take his third term in office. So he's going to also continue. These are the largest economies, increasingly even largest military powers. So they will have to deal with each other. There is no choice they have about it.
Right.
Except that there is also a bit of increasingly focus on nationalism, if not jingoism in case of China.
Right.
And this whole sense of rejuvenation of nation and the kind of benchmarks that Xi Jinping has to reinforce is being almost inevitable. And no one but Xi Jinping choice for the Chinese in that sense, which is not the case for Joe Biden. I'm sure they will have their own next election on time. And in that sense, I think the pressure to showcase a kind of grandstanding vis-a-vis United States in that sense becomes much more on President Xi Jinping. And therefore, you will notice that increasingly, U.S. will continue to be doing what President Joe Biden has been trying to put more subtle diplomacy of incremental change to be achieved in bilateral relationships, whereas Chinese would be looking at showcasing something which is really glaring and sharp. And you have to read, for example, editorials in Global Times, and the language they're using is very different. So I think it's going to be China acting a little more tough and the United States trying to manage them really well in terms of optics. But in reality, of course, on the ground, United States remains far ahead and far more capable, particularly with the whole set of friends and allies that it has. So India being closer to United States, they will continuously be of enormous advantage India in that sense in dealing with China.
Right. On that note, Professor Singh, thank you for making time for us here at DD India. Appreciate it.